I don't know if you heard Senator Sanders, but he would not commit to accepting money from Michael Bloomberg if Michael Bloomberg is not the Democratic nominee, right? He's pledged to help whoever is. Would you take his money and his support if you are the nominee?
Sure. As a matter of fact, look, you know, look right now, obviously, I'm competing against Mayor Bloomberg. We have, I think, different approaches and different visions. But, you know, his philanthropy supported a million-dollar effort in our community to help low-income people get transportation to go to work. I'm not going to reject that help because it came from a very wealthy person. This is the moment to bring everybody that we can into this effort. And I promise exactly one thing in return for any contribution, which is we're going to take that contribution and use it to go beat Donald Trump.
So, you know, you talk about something he did in your community, but obviously Amy Klobuchar has said Bloomberg is, her words, she's hiding behind his ad spending. Elizabeth Warren says he's bought his way onto the debate stage. Bernie Sanders has accused him of trying to buy the entire election. Pretty simple question, yes or no. Do you think Michael Bloomberg is trying to buy the Democratic nomination for president?
Yes. Yes. I mean, what else do you call it? What else do you call it when you dip into your endless reserves of millions and billions and don't go through the process of campaigning in states like Nevada or Iowa or New Hampshire, humbling yourself, going into the diners and the backyards, looking eye to eye to vote? Look, my campaign wouldn't exist if all that mattered was how much money and fame you start with and how you get yourself on the air. We built this thing from nothing. And we built it by having those conversations and letting voters pick apart what you have to say. And to try to just go around that by throwing colossal sums of money on television shows you what's wrong with our system. And I also believe it's not the best way to pick our nominee or the next president.
So I want to bring in Kristen Macatini now. She is a realtor and she is from Henderson, Nevada. She previously had supported Senator Kamala Harris, so she is now undecided. Go ahead with your question, please.
Thanks. Hi, Mayor Pete. Thanks for spending time with us tonight. As a fellow Episcopalian and Christian, it is very frustrating to hear so much of the public discourse that assumes that being a Christian equals evangelical Christian conservatism. My Episcopalian belief in Christianity teaches me the values of scripture, tradition, and reason. I am a Democrat and a Christian. You can be both. How can you use your voice as president to share this viewpoint more broadly when the right thinks they own it?
Well, first of all, I'm glad to be with a fellow Episcopalian. And I agree. Look, it starts with sending the message that God does not belong to a political party. And by the way, you know, it's also very important to make clear that the presidency and the Constitution and my presidency will belong to people of every religion and of no religion equally. This is not about imposing my faith on anybody. But I gotta say, like you, I find a message in Scripture that is very different from what the political right seems to want to talk about all the time. A lot about poverty, a lot about compassion, a lot about humility that I seek in my imperfect way to live up to. And that does have implications for how I will approach public office. And the time has come to send a message that people of faith have a choice. And if you belong to a Christian tradition or any moral or religious tradition that emphasizes making yourself useful to the oppressed and standing with and identifying with the prisoner and welcoming the stranger. Stranger, by the way, is another word for immigrant. Yes, that has implications in public life, and I won't be afraid to talk about how my positions are informed by my faith.
So, you know, to the point you talk about God not belonging to any kind of a political party, at the last CNN town hall, you said if your faith calls upon you to help the marginalized, those who are afflicted, to comfort people, to strive for humility and decency, as the Christian faith does. And then, I quote you, then, I just can't imagine that that requires of you that you be anywhere near this president. Do you think it is impossible to be a Christian and support President Trump?
Well, I'm not going to tell other Christians how to be Christians, but I will say I cannot find any compatibility between the way this president conducts himself and anything that I find in Scripture. Now, I guess that's my interpretation, but I think that's a lot of people's interpretation, and that interpretation deserves a voice.
I hate that anybody has to ask this question, but Mayor Pete, if you do become the nominee, how are you going to deal with the almost certain flood of personal attacks based on your sexual orientation?
Well, it'll happen, and I'm ready. You know, when I decided to come out in... When I decided to come out in... it was during a re-election year in South Bend. I was up for mayor. I decided after my deployment that I was just too old to not have a personal life, and made that personal decision, not knowing what the effect on my career would be or on being able to win. Mike Pence was the governor of Indiana then, and it was tough sledding for, as it still is, for many LGBTQ people in the state where I come from. And I just decided I had to do it. And what wound up happening was that I got reelected with 80% of the vote. And what that tells me was that at the end of the day, people were ready to judge me based on the job I was doing for them. But I also think it's important to recognize that change on these issues and acceptance and equality, even though it's got a long way to go, it's also happened at a pace that a lot of people are struggling with. And I think for those who haven't quite found their way all the way to the right side of history, it's important to beckon them in the right direction. I remember not long after I started dating Chasten, and I ran into a woman I knew in South Bend, older generation, a little more conservative, and she kind of gave me this mischievous pat on the arm, and she said, I met your friend the other day, and he is wonderful. You know, that could have been a moment to give her a lecture on the difference between, you know, your friend and your partner. But what I realized was in her way, she was kind of inching toward the direction of acceptance. She felt good about it. She felt good that she was moving in that way. And I think at a moment like this, it's really important that we find those who are maybe not quite there yet and help them get there instead of clubbing them over the head and telling them they're bad people until they see it just the right way. And I think that's a really important part of where our politics needs to go.
So last week, Rush Limbaugh made homophobic comments about you, and he said that America's not ready, he doesn't think, for a gay president. Now, then Limbaugh, I don't know if you know, but he gave this whole story today that President Trump told him, don't apologize for saying anything you said. Publicly, though, Trump says that he would not have a problem supporting a gay candidate. Do you take him at his word?
Well, not if he's sending out his supporters to talk in this way. And look, I mean, the idea of the likes of Rush Limbaugh or Donald Trump lecturing anybody on family values? I mean, I'm sorry, but one thing about my marriage is it's never involved me having to send hush money to a porn star after cheating on my spouse with him or her. So, they want to debate family values? Let's debate family values. I'm ready.
All right. Our next question is from Nick Elefantis. He is a high school government teacher. He is from Las Vegas and also undecided. Nicholas, please.
Good evening, Mayor Buttigieg.
Hi.
It's widely acknowledged that the public education system in Nevada and across the nation is broken. Part of it is due to the attrition of teachers. We're faced with low salaries and crippling student debt. What can be done to help keep hardworking, highly qualified teachers in their job instead of looking for the door?
Yeah. You may see Chasten, who's right next to you, is nodding along because he's a teacher with high student debt and who has dealt with low compensation. So we, as a household, you know, we understand what you're going through, and it is so important that we recruit and motivate and empower teachers to be in that profession. It's such an important profession. And yet, as we talked about earlier, teachers are now being expected to convert into highly trained armed guards. If there's a threat to the classroom, you're finding part of your job automated by the over-reliance on test administration. And then there's the simple fact that teachers are not paid enough. We can do something about that, and we should do something about that with federal funds. So I'm proposing that we triple the funds going into Title I in particular. Those are dollars that go into low-income districts, which is where having a great teacher is especially impactful, because low-income students, and disproportionately black and brown students, will perform better and earn more in the future, be more economically empowered if they have the best teachers. We also, I think, need to lift up the profession as a whole. I'm proposing we create a, I'm proposing that we create a an education access corps. The idea would be to link up high-quality teaching programs across the country, and if you participate in them and then commit to teaching in one of those Title I programs, you have a portable teaching license you could take anywhere, and you get your student loans forgiven if you do have that debt in exchange for agreeing to be a teacher in such an important area. Bottom line, as I like to say, is that if we respected our teachers just a little more like we do our soldiers and paid our teachers just a little more like we do our doctors, this country would be a better place for all of us.